Start, let us as a word of prayer. Gracious God, Heavenly Father, we just want to continue to thank you again and again for your love, for your grace, and for your mercy for us. We want to continue to come to you and rest our heart in you, knowing that, Lord, you are God who continue to grant us grace and mercy and help in times of needs and trouble. Lord, we thank you that we can go through this time together as a church to worship you, even in these new wonderful ways. Father Lord, we continue to ask that you watch over our nation and the world. Continue, Lord, to grant help, wisdom, and understanding, especially for the authority to be able to fight against this virus and bring back that new normality into our life, that we can continue to live the godly life to worship you in spirit and truth. Father Lord, even now we want to commit ourselves and ask that, Lord, you help us, Lord, to be attentive to your words. Grant us understanding and may the preaching of your words give us the encouragement and help us to face this virus and the challenges in our life, looking forward to the coming of our Lord Jesus Christ. Lord, help me, your servant, to preach forth your words. Anoint me with the power of your Holy Spirit. And thank you, Father, for this time we're going to have. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Very good morning to everyone. We are well into that 6 weeks of the MCO. How are you coping? I hope you're coping well. I have missed the company of all the fellowship of our people, except for the few that we continue to meet over the Zoom. I have missed many of you. And during this period, I hope you are doing well and sleeping well. You know, God grant those he loves with good sleep. And I hope you sleep well. But sleep is also likened to our death in this world. And that's what we want to look at today. That this picture that Paul brings to us of understanding how we are to prepare for his coming. And this pandemic has caused me to ponder about what is happening around us. And one of the things that I received during this time of meditation with our Lord is this heightened sense of his coming again. That's why today we want to look at the second coming of our Lord Jesus Christ. And I think it's so important for us to have a good understanding of this second coming of our Lord, because it helps us to live in times like this. That's why today we are going to look at this sermon entitled Be Awake, Watch and Be Ready, taken from 1 Thessalonians chapter 5, verse 1 to 8. Now this letter of Paul to the Thessalonians Christians is a very, very special letter. It is a letter that Paul wrote to them from Corinth. And with that special attention to want to encourage them to persevere in their tribulations and persecutions. You see, it is a very personal letter of Paul, of comfort and encouragement in testing times. If you look at the ministry of Paul, the background of it, that Paul was with them for a while, but because after that he has to leave them very fast. You see, when Paul was in Thessalonica, he started preaching in the synagogue. And then we are told there is a large number, a great number of the Gentile, the Greek speaking, came to know the Lord. And some Jews as well as well as some very prominent women. And that stirred up a lot of trouble by the Jews. The Jews were unhappy. They're not just unhappy, they are really angry. And they stir up trouble, so much so that Paul has to leave Thessalonica. And when he went to Berea, the Jews did not stop their trouble. They went there and caused even more trouble. And Paul has to run again, this time to Athens. And finally, he came to Corinth, and he has written this letter. Paul's heart is really for them. Paul has a very special... This Thessalonica Christian have a very special place in Paul's heart. You see, they are very special Christian. And in the letter, we can see that they have been doing well. They've been doing well with their faith and love. You see, Timothy came back and reported to Paul, as we can read in chapter 3, verse 6, that they were given good reports. Paul said, "You have encouraged me with your faith, with your love." But Paul has this heart for them that he wants to make sure they will persevere well and continue with their faith and love. And now he brings in hope of heaven. You see, for Paul, these Christians are so special. He in fact even says that they are his prized possession, that they are the hope of his glory, of his joy in heaven. When Paul goes back to heaven, these brethren are the one that Paul looked forward to see together. And that's why Paul wants to bring this hope of heaven now to them, to like for he himself, that Paul in his life have found this hope in God. It's so powerful for him to continue to persevere. In fact, in Romans chapter 8, verse 18, Paul tells us that he considered that his present suffering are not worth comparing with the glory that will be revealed in him. And that's why Paul wants to bring heaven to the Thessalonica Christians. That heaven is not just a destination, but a motivation for them to live, to persevere in such time. And this is what we want to go and look at it in this sermon. But before this, we know that Paul brings in the concept of heaven to them in chapter 4. That he tells them that those who fall asleep, those who die, we are not to be ignorant. And Paul tells them very clearly, heaven is going to come. All the dead will rise, and those who are alive will also rise with him. Therefore the Lord himself will come down from heaven with a loud command, with the voice of the archangel, and with the trumpet call of God, and the dead in Christ will rise first. And these Corinthian Christians are given that hope of heaven, of coming back to our Lord Jesus when he comes again. But this must have aroused some questions in them. They must have been thinking, what does it mean? What is this Jesus coming again? How is he going to come? When is he going to come? And how am I going to join him? And those are the questions that Paul comes to address for us, because we know we are also going through tough times. The COVID-19 pandemic has shaken our confidence. It has given us a new way of looking at life. Even when the pandemic is over, there's going to be a new normal that comes into our life. And we're going to continue to face testing time. And just like those Christians in Thessalonians, you know, Paul wrote this letter because they were going through severe suffering and people has died. So he comes to reassure them that those who die, let us know what happened to them. Don't be discouraged. They have gone. They have a place to go. And same thing for us. I think this pandemic has taken a toll on many people. Even the death, the number of deaths in the world has exceeded 200,000. There are more than 3 million cases today. And in Malaysia, we have 100 deaths right now. And more will come. And other things, all the repercussions, people are suffering. We know jobs are lost. New graduates, we're just told they are going to have problems getting jobs. And those assisting business will go into trouble as well. So there are times of great challenges ahead of us. And we can identify with Paul, because as he is concerned to see all these Christians persevere to the end, that he'll meet them in heaven. We, as a church, we want to do that. I want to do that. I want to see every one of us come back together and meet each other in heaven one day. And that's why I want to bring this message, which is very close to Paul's heart and my heart for you. How are we going to get ourselves ready? How are we going to, you know, make sure that we continue to persevere in this time? And that's why we want to look at this message that Paul tells us, that we are to be awake, to watch and be ready. And this is taken from 1 Thessalonians chapter 5, verse 1 to 8. Let us go to the scripture. Now, brothers and sisters, about times and dates, we do not need to tell you, for you know very well that the day of the Lord will come like a thief in the night. While people are saying peace and safety, destruction will come on them suddenly, as labor pains on a pregnant woman, and they will not escape. For you, brothers and sisters, are not in darkness, so that this day should surprise you like a thief. You are all children of the light and children of the day. We do not belong to the day or to the darkness. So then let us not be like others who are asleep, but let us be awake and sober. For those who sleep, sleep at night, and those who get drunk at night. But since we belong to the day, let us be sober, putting on faith and love as a breastplate, and the hope of salvation as a helmet. Now, these are the word of Paul to them, to get them to be ready, to understand how the Lord is going to come again, and what are they to do as they persevere in these times of trouble. And there are three things that Paul tells us in this passage that we will look at. The first thing, that Jesus is going to come back again at any moment, and he is going to come, and before he comes, there are clear signs of his coming. For his children, be certain that he's coming at any moment, but there are clear signs for us, the children, to look out for. And what we need to do is to be awake, watch, and be ready. Be awake, watch, and be ready. Let's go to that. The first one, he will come back at any time. You see, the coming back is certain, but the coming back is unexpected. Now, brothers and sisters, about times and dates, we do not need to write to you, for you know very well that the day of the Lord will come like a thief in the night. It is for certain Jesus will come. The day of the Lord in Scripture refers to the day when Jesus is going to come again to judge the dead and the living. And on his return, and this is given to us in many passages that you can look up in Ezekiel 30 verse 3, Joel chapter 1 verse 15, 2, chapter 2 verse 1, Amos, Malachi, and Acts chapter 2 verse 20, and 1 Thessalonians chapter 5 verse 2, 2 Thessalonians chapter 2 verse 1, and so on. There are many. What is telling us that the day of the Lord will come? It is certain Jesus will come. But the way he comes is what we need to be looking up. It is going to be unexpected and painful. Paul gave two analogies here. One is that he will come like a thief in the night, when you would not know, because the thief comes at the time when you are sleeping. And another one is that it's going to be labor pain, the onset of labor. You know, a pregnant woman who is having a baby and they're well advanced into the pregnancy, but they will not know when the labor will start. There is a suddenness. There is this unexpected. And with that come pain. And people of the world will not know. They will be saying peace and safety when destruction will come upon them suddenly. People of the world will be surprised when Jesus comes again. But not so. Not so for us. Not so for us, his children. There are clear signs of his coming. There are clear signs of his coming. And we are given the privilege to know. But you, brothers and sisters, are not in darkness, so that this day should surprise you like a thief. You are children of the light and children of the day. We do not belong to the night or to the darkness. You see, we are children of the light and day. We are privileged. In fact, the disciples of Jesus came to Jesus and asked about this, his coming back again. And then Jesus made it very clear in Matthew that the day and the time, you would not know. And in fact, even I don't know, Jesus said, but only the Father knows about the days and hours that he will come. And people will be not knowing, they'll be eating and drinking, marrying and giving in marriage, and go on buying and selling like the day of Noah. But not so for us. Jesus said, you will know. There are signs for you. And you will know. You are to look out. You are children of the light. You see, Jesus is the light of life. Jesus gives us life. But Jesus also gives us truth. He gives us wisdom and understanding of the times. We are like sons of Issachar, that we understood the times we live in and knew and know what we are to do like the Israelites. And that's who we are. We are children of the light and day who are given this privilege to come to know what is happening around us, to be able to understand the signs around us of Jesus coming again. And very quickly, and I just want to show you that there are clear signs of his coming. Matthew chapter 24, verse 6 to 31, which could take another sermon to preach, but in summary, Jesus went on to demonstrate for them. There are clear signs, there are four of them that you can look out for. Something happening in the world, in the church, in Jerusalem, and in the sky. That the world will experience this war and rumors of war, famine, earthquake, three things. And then the church, three things as well. Universal persecution will come. The church will be persecuted. And some of the Christians will backslide and become nominal. But the word of God will spread. The word of God will be preached to all nations, all ethnic groups before he comes again. And this is something that is ongoing. You can see what is happening in the world is already happening. What is in the church is also happening. But we are still waiting for that happening in Jerusalem when the Antichrist comes, that Daniel prophesies. And then when he comes, it will be very acute, very serious. And then it will come suddenly, very fast, then the sky will be darkened. The moon and the light will lose its light. The star will stop shining. And then Jesus will come, like what we read earlier, with the trumpet, the archangel, and we will rise with him. There are clear signs. Go and read Matthew chapter 24. And there are clear signs. But it's not the signs we have to be careful or look out for only. We are to be aware of the false prophets and the false Christ. They can come to deceive us. And this is why Paul now, to bring them to the attention, that they are to be awake, watch, and be ready. So then, let us not be like others who are asleep, but let us be awake and sober. For those who sleep, sleep at night. And those who get drunk at night. Keep our eyes open. Trust your eyes, not your ears. You're going to hear a lot of rumors. Your eyes, keep it open. Don't sleep. Wake up and live in the light of day. We have to do this. We have to keep our eyes awake and open and watch and be discerning. And be discerning and be able to filter all the things that can come to tempt us. That all the false prophets who come to give you peace, peace, but there is no peace. Give you false comfort. Tell you everything will be okay. Everything will be beautiful today or tomorrow. No, the Bible tells us we are going through testing times. Troubles comes, but we face them because God is merciful and gracious. God is good. We keep our eyes open and look at Jesus our Lord. And this is important at such time like this. Keep awake and look at Jesus. Look for the sign of his coming, but look at Jesus and learn to do what is good. Live in the light. You see, Paul tells us very clearly we have to be sober and wise. But since we belong to the day, let us be sober. Be sober. Don't get drunk with wine. But like he tells us in Ephesians, we have to be discerning. That we get drunk with the Holy Spirit. Be careful then how you live. Not as unwise, but as wise. Making the most of every opportunity. Because the days are evil. We're living in this time called the end of time, end times, where Jesus is giving us a period to live before he comes again. And this are day where the enemy continue to roam and to attack. We are to watch out. But it is also a time for opportunity. It is not a time of despair, of false hope, of false security. We don't have to do that because we are secure in Christ. But we are to make this opportunity to live a life worthy of his calling. Continue to persevere. And what we are, how we're going to do is that we keep ourselves sober. We are filled with the Spirit. Do not get yourself drunk with wine, which leads to debauchery, all the wrong things. But we keep ourselves righteous and live a life of holiness, discerning all the things that comes to us. Be careful of all the false teaching. Be led and filled by the Spirit to filter, to listen, and to discern well. What are we to do? And there are many fake news. There are many things that can come to disturb our hearts today, especially in time like this. You can see that the world is really totally out of control. Even America, the strongest and richest country, they are the epicenter. Can you imagine that? They have handled the thing so badly. Is that really possible for us to imagine the strongest nation with the most wealth and supposed to be the most advanced in scientific and medical advances? Look at what's happening. People in America are on the street doing all sorts of things for their own freedom. Even a haircut has become more important than taking care of your neighbors and make sure the virus doesn't spread. We are living in time that we need discernment. We need the Word of God. We need to be sober, be filled with the Spirit, and be wise, and live the life as a children of light. We are children of light. We are no longer in darkness. Ephesians tells us that we are children of light because we have been saved. We have been taken out of that darkness and we are called the children of light. That's who we are. In times like this, we are the children of light in this world that bring light into the world. We even expose darkness and we are to live these last days with the opportunity given to us to shine for Jesus. And Paul gives them this armor to put, putting on faith and love as breastplate and the hope of salvation as a helmet. You see, Paul used two pieces here. We know there are six pieces in Ephesians. But look at these two pieces. They are so important for us to persevere. Paul is talking about them getting persevere as the enemy comes and all the false accusation and false prophets and false information that comes. You are to get your heart steady, peace, faith, and love on your breastplate. And you are always assured of your salvation that you're going back to our Lord Jesus. The hope that you need to look forward to as you continue to live a life of faith and love. See, hope is so important. Sometimes we misplace hope, you know. We think that love and faith, yes, love and faith are very important for our life here, but faith and love need hope to thrive. We need to have hope to, in order to continue in our faith and love of God and one another, isn't it? That's why this hope, I want you to look at heaven again today. I want you to look at hope. Do you live with hope? Because it is so crucial in times like this when we are going to face more challenges and troubles. Hope will spur us on as we continue to live with faith and love of God for us. And this is what Paul wants to bring to them. They are good Christians. They are faithful Christians. They are loving Christians. But Paul can see challenge going to come. Enemies are coming upon them. They need to have something to anchor their assurance of their salvation. And that is hope. The hope of glory. That's what we want to do today as we face COVID-19. We are be very clear that Jesus is coming again. Jesus is coming again. It is certain, no doubt, it's the way he comes. The way he comes. But we are children of light. We are given the privilege to know the times we are living in and to know the signs to look out for clearly. Clearly, that how when Jesus is getting nearer, you know, as I say, the four signs, the first two are already happening. The last two will come. You will come. But we will know. It's at any moment, but we have the privilege to know. Watch and be ready. Watch and be ready. And be discerning. Be discerning. Don't listen to everything or hear and see things with your eyes alone. Just don't just be discerning. Ask the Holy Spirit. Go to God. The Word of God for us. Be led by the Spirit to have understanding of what we are hearing. The false prophets that comes, all sort of teaching may come just to soothe your soul, but not for that life that we are called to live. I know many of us are going through difficulty. I know with this MCO, even those who are sick find difficulty to get attended to. Those in the aged care home especially, we have our residents who have passed away, and people who pass on also have difficulty have a proper funeral or send off. And as I say, there are more things to come in the coming days. Let us be discerning. Let us watch, keep our eyes on our Lord Jesus, and be ready for his coming. And persevere. The time's going to be how long, we don't know. The new normal will come, but even then, it's going to be some testing period for us with this new normal. Don't give up. You know Noah? Noah was a righteous man, and he brought his family into that boat, and he has to wait. He has to wait for the day they will see the land again, for the day they will come back to that great place where God is taking them. But in those 1 whole year, they wait, and they are inside. You know, when you're inside the same place for a long time, sometimes trouble will come. You need to learn to love one another. And they need to work. They have to take care of all the animals. I think it's the same thing for us. As we go through MCO or all this new normal that come, the restriction that come upon our life, let us continue to persevere with that, with the love of God for us and the life that he calls us to. Let us remember, even today, I know the MCO, we are reading that domestic violence has increased. Even domestic killing, murder has increased in UK. And this is what happened. Let us stay with that steadiness in the Lord. Persevere like Noah and the family. And continue to do the work that we are called to do. Continue to live loving one another. Take care of each other as we continue to wait for the day the relief will come. And don't sleep too much. I know it's good to sleep, it's good to rest, good opportunity for you to sleep, but don't sleep too much. And don't get fat. Exercise, especially your spiritual muscle. You know, you look at this when the COVID-19 is over. Are you going to be able to get up? I hope you can get up, because I hope you don't get fat in your body, but get fat in our spiritual muscle. Let us be fat disciples of Jesus Christ. Live with this faith. Live with the hope and the love of Christ for us. We live with that faith, be faithful. F for faithful. Let us continue to have faith in God. We can have faith in God because of who he is, because of his word for us, because of his promise, because of his presence and his power that go with us, and the great purpose he has for us as his children. We can be faithful because God is faithful. God is good. But be available. Love. We receive the love. Let's extend love. And this is something we take care of each other in that small way or big ways. You can go and help your neighbors or help and love each other in times of needs. And this is something that is very going on a lot now, and I hope you participate as well. Let's extend our love and be teachable. You see, time of testing, persecutions or whatever is for time of learning. It's for us to learn and grow. And it's a wonderful opportunity. Like Paul said, he in fact, Paul looked at his suffering in a very positive way. Because since we have been saved, he tells us in Romans chapter 5, since we have been saved by grace, we rejoice in the hope of the glory of God. We are so sure of our future. Not only so, but we also rejoice in our suffering, because suffering produces perseverance. Perseverance, character, and character, hope. And hope does not disappoint. Because it is during this time we receive the power of the Holy Spirit that gives us the love of Christ. It is in this time we receive and experience the power of the Holy Spirit that comes to help us. It's in times of testing that we learn and grow. And because of the hope we have, we can go through it. We can persevere and continue to trust, obey, and do what God says and serve Him for His glory. And that's why hope, live with hope, is so important to be that good, fat disciples of Jesus. So I want to encourage all of us to continue to do so. And I want to give you a good news. Pain, birth pain of joy is coming, do you know? That's why we want to have a very clear understanding of heaven. Whatever we live today, there is a connection to heaven, do you know? You see, when you talk about birth pain, yes, it is painful. It is painful. But how about the joy that comes after that? How about the joy that comes after the baby has come out, and the joy, the abundant joy that we're going... And this is what Jesus is telling us. Yes, you're going to go through birth pain. It is going to be unexpected, sudden, painful. But when it comes, the result is going to be wonderful. For those of us who are with Jesus, Jesus coming is a cause for celebration, not dismay. It's a cause for celebration. And I want to give you a very clear picture that whatever we do on earth brings us to heaven for a good reason. And why we are living the way we live today? Because of what Jesus has in store for us in heaven. When you go back to heaven, you're not just going to a place where you don't do anything. It's going to be full of life. I'm going to take you in the coming days to look at heaven again, so that we can have a clear understanding of this heaven that is awaiting us, for us to join Jesus in that wonderful reunion for the life with Him of what? The kingdom of God that has come fully. Jesus come to earth, say, I come, good news, I bring the kingdom here now for you to experience. But the day, Revelation 20, we're going to go to Revelation in the coming days. The picture of that millennium, that 1,000 years of rule of Christ on earth, we are going to be with Him. Clear and important for us to hold on to as we go through troubles. It's all for a good reason. We end up in that perfect kingdom when Jesus comes again and He rules on earth. We continue to live, to work, to worship, and to enjoy Him and glorify Him in that perfect way. All the good thing, all the peace, perfect prosperity, the perfect things that Jesus talked about in His kingdom is going to come. It's going to come. It's for certain. It comes. Because our Lord Jesus has given us this promise. And so, Holy Light, let us come, even during this difficult time, let's continue now to give ourselves to this heavenly glory. That whatever we are doing here, it's going to continue into that heaven. And that's why we are here, to persevere and live the life that Jesus asks us, to be worthy of His calling, to be His children, to be the light. We are given the light, and we are to shine this light to places. Jesus will shine through us, and we get ready for His coming again. Thank you, Father, for His wonderful words and assurance for us. Let us pray. Our gracious God, Heavenly Father, we want to thank You again and again for the words that are spoken to us through Paul. That, Lord, we can see how in our struggles today with this pandemic and other things that come to our life, all the challenges, all the pain, and all those of us who are going through sickness, those of us who suffer financial loss, and those of us who are going to have all the problem, all the difficulty that comes, we can continue to look to you. We know that, Lord, you give us understanding and wisdom, and to continue to look forward to the time when you will come again. But you give us that faith, that love, and this hope to live, to persevere in such a time. Help us, Father, Lord, to have a refreshed understanding of what is in store for us in heaven, that we will continue to pursue you and pursue our life for your glory in times like this. Thank you, Father. We commit ourselves into your hand. Pray all this in Jesus' name.
Hide me now under trust. When the oceans rise and thunders roll, I will soar with you above the storm. Father, you are king over the flood. I will be still, know you are God. When the oceans rise and thunders roll, I will soar with you above the storm. Father, you are king over the flood. I will be still, know you are God. I will be still, know you are God.
And now receive the benediction. To him who is able to keep you from stumbling and to present you before his glorious presence without fault and with great joy. To the only God, our Savior, be glory, majesty, power, and authority through Jesus Christ our Lord, before all ages, now and forevermore.